Hey, Westover students, it's Isaiah again. Hey, guys, it's Joanna again.
Nice you've to done see it twice. It's my turn.
Hi, welcome to the
I think it's my turn. Hey guys, my name is Eddie. I'm one of the high school small group leaders here, specifically the sophomore guys. Those are my guys. Hello, people. Make sure to subscribe and click that little notification bell so that you don't miss out on any of our other videos. Also, make sure to follow us on Instagram, TikTok, Snapchat, and Facebook. Yes, we have Facebook. I don't even know how to use Facebook. Without further ado, let's get straight into For Your Entertainment.
Notice how mad the girl in the audience is when Harry is hugging her.
Can I just say, those TikToks had me LOLing. Make sure to check out the new worship video. It's gonna be right here. We have a game for you guys. So last week we hit Lame Joss on Instagram, that's her at, and here's where she was.
One really tall.
Nadia found her in last week's video, so we're gonna go ahead and put her in today's sermon. Make sure to screenshot where you found her and use the hashtag #FindTheStudent and make sure to tag us so that you have a chance to be hidden in the next video. So now, Felipe is gonna go ahead and transition us to our next scene. Go ahead and fly away, Felipe.
Hello, I'm Pastor Tito. I'm one of the next gen pastors here at Westover Hills. And we've been in a conversation about all things love, dating, and relationships. We're calling it online dating. And if you wanna catch up and watch full messages, you can click the playlist or you can click the link in the description below. Now let me get started with some really good news. God is not out to destroy your love life. I mean, amen, like praise the Lord, that's awesome, right? God just doesn't want your love life to destroy you. And here's the thing, dating doesn't have to be a train wreck. And if you were to ask me, Pastor Tito, what do you mean by dating? Here's my definition. Dating is meant to be a process of evaluation. It's a way you figure out whether the person you're talking to is the person you wanna be talking to for the next 60 years of your life. And the best way to do that is to break it down into two areas. The first is character. This is what kind of person are they? This includes their values, and that's so important. And the second is this, chemistry. Do you get along? Do y'all fit well? Are you like peanut butter and jelly? So for today, we have a list for you that we're gonna be covering over the next couple of weeks. And here it is, 7 things to look for in the person that you may wanna marry or date. Now the first 4 are part of a character conversation, and we'll be talking about those today. But the next 3 are part of a chemistry conversation, and we'll be talking about those next week. So here we go, drum roll everybody. Number 1, we're talking about character. Are they a believer in Jesus? Now, if Jesus is your North Star, if Jesus is the most important thing to you, and Jesus is to whom you tie your allegiance, and he's whom you get your direction from, he's your moral compass, then it is so important that the person you choose to date lines up in this area. Now listen to what Paul says. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, he says a verse that many of you may be familiar with. Don't team up with those who are unbelievers. Now maybe you've heard this verse before, and it was stated in the King James as don't be unequally yoked. But another way to say that is don't team up with those who are unbelievers. How can righteousness be a partner with wickedness? How can light live with darkness? What harmony can there be between Christ and the devil? How can a believer be a partner with an unbeliever? And what union can there be between God's temple and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. Should we be friends with people who aren't Christians? Absolutely, 100%. You should have friends who don't believe the way you do, who don't think the way you do. That is so vital and so important. But here's what I mean. The people that are your best besties, the ones that you share everything with, those should be people that have the same allegiance and are going the same direction that you're going to. Now, that may not sound like a big deal right now, but at some point, that will become a big, big thing. Now, besides, if you're not a Christian, You don't want to date a Christian. Like, you don't want to do that. It would be so boring for you. It would drive you crazy. You'd be like, hey, let's go to the club and shake it like a Polaroid picture. And they'd be like, no, I'd rather go to Bible study and shake up my complacency. Or what about this? Hey, let's go to the bar and do some shots. And they're like, no, I'd rather take a shot of the Holy Ghost in prayer. You know what I'm saying? And when you get married, you bind yourself together till death do you part. And if you're a Christian, you're choosing to live by faith, to trust in Jesus, to do what he does, to go where he goes, to value what he values, and to pursue and chase after Christ. If you're not a Christian, then you're not doing that. And that doesn't mean you're a bad person, and I'm not here to judge you, nothing like that. All I'm saying is that your big goal in life isn't to bring glory and honor to Jesus. And while starting out in a relationship, it may not be that big a deal when you're sitting next to each other at a game or when you're watching the same show on Netflix, but it's very different when you get married. And suddenly you're both deciding how you're gonna spend your money and how you're gonna raise your kids. And one of you will either compromise and give up on something that they believe, or the other one is just gonna be dragged to church constantly and forced to do stuff they don't wanna do. It's not enough to marry for charm. It's not enough to marry for hot. And at some point, your relationship is gonna require something deeper out of the two of you. And if one of you is a Christian and one of you isn't, your direction, your end goal, your allegiance are all so different. So don't settle. Second question, are they a pursuer of Jesus? I mean, are they striving after him? Are they following him, trying to become more like him in their everyday? Because here's the thing, Hitler claimed to be a Christian. Hitler claimed to believe in Jesus. But just because you meet a guy in church doesn't make him a Christian. It doesn't make him a follower of Jesus. Just because he's wearing Nike doesn't make him an athlete. Listen to this song that Jewish followers of God used to sing with one another. Psalm 1. Blessed is the one who does not walk in the step of the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yield its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. In other words, when you find a guy who's like this, they offer stability, like a tree that's planted by streams of water. And it says that they bear fruit, that they're good things that come out from them. And it says that whatever they do prospers. Check this out, Proverbs 31. This is a proverb written down from the sayings of a king named Lemuel. Verse 25, it says, she is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed. Her husband also, he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Here's a good test. Are you ready? How do you know if the person you're interested in really loves Jesus or not? And this is a question I used to have all the time, because I would meet someone and they would say they love Jesus, they would say that they're a Christian, but when I looked at their lives, it didn't seem to line up. Now here's a test you can use on yourself, you can use when you're picking your friends, you can use even in figuring out who you want to date. Check it out, Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. This is Paul talking. He says, so I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other so that you're not free to carry out your good intentions. But when you're directed by the Spirit, you are not under the obligation to the laws of Moses. If you've been following Jesus more than 20 minutes, you know that's true. Because there's part of you that really wants to do right, but there's another part of you that just wants to do everything that you know you shouldn't. Listen to how Paul addresses this in verse 19. He says, when you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. That's the first test. Here's the second. Are you giving in one of these areas? Sexual immorality. Now, this is what we call a junk drawer term. Maybe you have a junk drawer at your house where you have all this like random stuff in it that you don't really know what to do with. That's what this term is. Sexual immorality includes anything that isn't pure. For instance, are you looking at a guy or a girl for too long and craving them and desiring things that you shouldn't and having impure thoughts? These are all included. Or maybe you're wanting something that you can't have. Or what about hostility, quarreling, and jealousy? Do these traits define you? Is this something that you need to look at? Be honest with yourself. What about outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, and division? If any of those traits are you, then friend, you are not pursuing Jesus. Because when you pursue Jesus, you'll sound more like this. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. There's no law against such things. And I've heard people do this, and I think this is so smart. It makes so much sense. They'll take their own name, or they'll take the name of the person they're interested in, and they'll ask the question, does Tito have love? Does Melissa have joy? Does Nadia have patience? Does Jason have self-control? And if you have to say no, then friends, you're not pursuing God, or they're not pursuing God. And it's evidence because there's no evidence. And here's what Paul said about that in another letter he wrote. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. When I wrote to you before, I told you not to associate with people who indulge in sexual sin. But I wasn't talking about unbelievers who indulge in sexual sin, or are greedy or cheat people or worship idols. You'd have to leave this world to avoid people like that. Verse 11, I meant that you are not to associate with anyone who claims to be a believer yet indulges in sexual sin, or is greedy, or worships idols, or is abusive, or is a drunkard, or cheats people. Don't even eat with such people. Man, Paul encourages us, when it comes to unbelievers, we should love them. We should care for them. We should spend time with them. We should invest in them. But here's where Paul draws the line. He says, when it comes to people who say they love Jesus, but intentionally choose not to live for him, intentionally choose to violate God's word, to violate the Holy Spirit, intentionally choose to violate the teachings of Jesus, you don't want that guy. You don't want that girl. That is the most dangerous kind of person. I mean, think of it. Is he pressuring you sexually? Then you need to run. You don't need to stick behind and try to fix him or try to help him. It is not your job to save him. It's God's job. You need to run before you get trapped. And you want a guy who is the master of his own lusts and his own desires when he had no other allegiance to do it other than his allegiance to Christ. Because then one day, fast forward to when you get married, you have no reason to worry when he goes out of town on a business trip. Number three, are they keeping the same pace as you? Imagine, there's one guy, he wants to be a missionary to the Muslim world, and he meets this girl, and she like just got saved, and she's like, oh, this is a Bible. And he's trying to pull her along with him, and she's like, oh my gosh, I don't want to die. I mean, the person that you date will either double your effectiveness or cut it in half. Think of it this way. If your life is a marathon, then you want to be very careful about the direction that you're going. And you want to make sure that whoever it is that you're linking up with, that you're both going the same direction, that you're running after him, you're going closer to him, you're moving in his direction, you're avoiding what he's telling you to avoid, and you're going where he's telling you to go. And as you're running this way, people are going to be all around you. They're going to be crisscrossing your path. They're going to be going completely different directions. But if you're not wise, you'll assume just because they're in your field of vision that God's the one bringing them to your attention. When really, they're going a completely different way than you are. But here's the hope for the person you date, that as you're running hot after God, you would look beside you and there's someone, and they're not only running the same direction as you, but they're running the same speed as you, and they're keeping the same pace as you, if not a little faster, because you want someone that you have to run to keep up with, not someone you have to drag along. And these should be non-negotiables, though I know for many of you, they're really not. But I think the reason that is because you're not that serious about your relationship with Jesus. Jesus is just a religion to you. He's just a set of do's and don'ts, and you don't know him and you don't really love him. Now, for the next question on this list and many of the questions that we're gonna hit next week, you're gonna bend. There's gonna be a give and take, but our question for you is just how much do you wanna bend? Number four, are you theologically compatible? Catholic, Protestant. What kind of church do you wanna go to? Do you like to go to the kind of church where they're really expressive in worship and they lift their hands? Or do you like to go to the kind of church where you just grab a coffee and you sit down in your seat and you just kind of watch? Do you believe in tithing, giving 10% of everything God has given you back to God? Or do you kind of think that all of your money belongs to you and you're the master of your own fate? You want to agree as much as possible in these areas, but there are some areas that you're gonna need to figure out ahead of time. I know we've given you a lot to think about, but hopefully we've given you some good ways to help you find the right person. But let me say this with all the sincerity I have, it is better to be single than to marry the wrong person. I mean, just ask anybody who's gone through the pain of divorce or anybody who's been cheated on. And here's the thing, friends, God wants better for you. We want better for you. And God would have it. His hope is that when you finally find the person that you want to spend the rest of your life with, that it would actually be a good thing and that you would have no regrets. Man, I would love, love to pray for you if you'd bow your heads and close your eyes right now. Father, we love you. We trust you. We thank you that your word says that you are working all things together for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. Father, that's the conversation we're in. God, we're talking to people who've given their lives to you who are called, who love you, and you're leading them, you're directing them, and that's why this is such a big deal. Because we're not like the rest of the world. We can't just date any random person because you've called us and you have a destiny for us. You have plans for our lives. Father, help us to realize that you have big plans for our lives and that we don't want to miss it. Because the person we date and the person we marry can either double our effectiveness or it can cut it in half. God, this is such a big deal. This is such a serious conversation. So I pray you lead us and you direct us to have the hard talks with our friends, to have the hard talks with our parents, to have the hard talks with our life group leaders over the next several weeks. Give us wisdom to know what to do, but also give us the courage to actually do it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Friends, we're so thrilled that you decided to tune in with us today, and we cannot wait to see you next week.
Welcome back. We missed you guys. Remember to check out the new worship song, and remember to find the student with the hashtag #FindTheStudent. Okay, bye.